What do you want? Stay where you are, you're dripping wet.
It's God's blessed rain, my child.
The devil's bloody rain, more like.
Well, Regina, the way you talk.
Don't make such a noise without foot. The young master's asleep upstairs.
Still in bed at this hour? Why, the day's half gone.
It's none of your business.
I was out drinking last night.
Sure.
This has got my witness house at my bench by 5:30 this morning.
Yes, yes, come on now. I don't want to be caught having a rendezvous with you.
Having what?
I don't want anyone to see you here. Get out.
Not until I've had a word with you. This afternoon, I'll have finished my work at the orphanage and the new schoolhouse. And tonight, I'm catching the steamer back to town.
Bon voyage.
What? They're dedicating the orphanage tomorrow. And there'll be celebration with lots of drinks. And Pastor Manders is expected from town.
He's arriving today.
Well, there you are. So I shall not be here. I'm not bloody well risking getting into his bad books.
Oh, so that's it.
What do you mean?
What are you trying to fool the pastor into this time?
Me? Fool Pastor Manders? Oh, no. He's far too good a friend to me for that. But what I wanted to talk to you about was this. I am going home tonight.
Sooner the better.
Yes. And I want to take you with me.
You want to take me?
I want to take you with me, I
say. Home with you. Not likely, I won't.
We'll see. We'll see.
You bet your life we'll see. You expect me to go back and live with you in that house? After Mrs. Elving's brought me up and treats me as though I was one of the family? Get out.
Are you setting yourself up against your father?
You've said often enough that I'm no concern of yours.
Oh. You mustn't take any notice of that.
Well, what about all the times you've sworn at me and called me a... Oh, mon Dieu.
God strike me dead if I ever use such a vile word.
Oh, I know what word you use.
Yes, yes, yes. But that was only when I was... wasn't myself. The temptations of this world are manifold, my child. Oh. And when your mother was being difficult, I had to find somewhere to knock her. Always acting the grand lady!
Poor mother. You killed her soon enough with your bullying.
That's right. That's right. Blame me for everything.
Oh, and that leg.
What was that, my child?
Pied de mouton.
What's that, English?
Yes.
Ah, well, they've made a scholar out of you out here anyway, and that'll come in handy now, my child.
What was it you wanted me for in town anyway?
Well, fancy asking such a question. What would a father want with his only child? Aren't I a lonely, forsaken widower?
Oh, don't try to fool me with all that rubbish. What was it you wanted me for?
Well, you see, it's like this. I was thinking of starting out on something new.
You've tried that often enough. You've always made a mess.
Yes,
of
but
it.
This time you'll see, Regina. God rot
Stop
me if
I. Oh.
How right you are, my child. But what I wanted to say was this. I've put quite a bit of money aside from this work on the orphanage.
Have you? Good for you.
Yes, well, there ain't much for a man to spend his money on out here in the country, is there?
Well, go on.
Yes, well, so, I thought I'd put my money into something that might bring in a bit. A kind of hostelry for sailors.
Oh, my God.
A real smart place, you understand? Not one of those low waterfront joints. No! Damn it, this is going to be for officers and captains and such like. Well, you're going to help me. Just for appearance's sake, of course. You won't have to work hard, my child. You can fix your own hours.
I see.
But there has to be a bit of skirt on show. I mean, that's obvious. Got to give him a bit of fun in the evening, singing, dancing, and so forth. You must remember that these men are wandering seafarers, lost on the ocean of life. Now, don't be stupid and make things difficult for yourself, Regina. What can you make of yourself out here? What good is it going to do you, all this fine education Mrs. Alving's given you? I hear you're going to look after the orphans up the street. Is that what you want? Are you really so anxious to ruin your health on those filthy brats?
No, if things work out the way that I... Well, they might. They might.
What do you mean?
This money you've managed to save, is it a lot?
All told, I'd say it comes to between 700 and 800 crowns.
Not bad.
Enough to make a start on my child.
Well, aren't you going to give me any of it?
Not bloody likely, I'm not.
Aren't you even going to send me a new dress?
You come back to town. Set up with me. And you'll get dresses enough.
I could do that on my own if
no,
I wanted to.
No, Regina. You need a father's hand to guide you. There's a nice house I can get on Little Harbour Street. They don't want much cash on the nail. And we could turn it into a sort of, well, mission for sailors.
But I don't want to live with you. I don't want anything to do with you. Get out.
But you wouldn't have to stay with me for long, my child. What was the pity? If you play your cards properly, the way you've blossomed out in recent years...
Yes?
Well, you'll never wait long before some nice officer, perhaps even
I
a captain...
I don't want to marry any of them. Sailors haven't any savoir-vivre.
Haven't any what?
I know sailors. There's no future in marrying them.
All right, then don't marry them. You can do just as well without. The Englishman, the one with a yacht. He paid out 700 crowns. And she was no prettier than you.
Get out!
You wouldn't hit your father.
Wouldn't I? You say another word about my mother and you'll see. And don't slam the door. Young Mr. Irving's asleep.
Heather, is he asleep? Why do you fuss so much about... You wouldn't be thinking of him, would you?
Adam, be quick about it. You're out of your mind. No, not that way. Here's Pastor Mander's out through the kitchen.
All right, I'll go. But you ask him. Ask in reverence what a child's duty is to its father. Huh. And I am your father, whatever you may say. I can prove it from the parish register.
Good morning, Miss Engstrand.
Hi, Pastor Mander's. Has the boat arrived already?
Yes, it arrived a few minutes ago. Very tiresome, this rain we're having.
Blessing for the farmers, though, sir.
Ah, yes, you're right there. We city people tend to forget that.
Oh, it's soaking. I'll let your umbrella out.
Ah, it's good to be under a dry roof again. I trust all is well here?
Yes, thank you, sir.
You are very busy, I suppose. Getting ready for tomorrow?
Yes, there are one or two things to be done.
Mrs. Alving is at home, I hope.
Yes, sir. She's upstairs.
Ah, yes. I heard when I got off the boat that Oswald had returned.
Yes, he arrived the day before yesterday. We hadn't expected him until today.
In good health and spirits, I trust?
Yes, thank you, sir. I think so. He felt dreadfully tired after his journey. He came from Paris in one go. Par rapide. I think he's asleep now, so we better talk just a tiny bit quietly.
Shh. We'll be like mice.
Now, sit down, sir, and make yourself comfortable.
Thank you. Do you know, Miss Engstrand, I really do believe you've grown since I last saw you.
Do you think so, too? Mrs. Alving says I've rounded out a bit.
A little, perhaps. Not too much.
Shall I tell Madam you've come?
Thank you, my child, but there's no hurry. Tell me, Regina, how's your father getting on out here?
Thank you, Percy. He's doing very well.
He came to see me when he was in town last.
No, did he really? He's always so happy when he gets a chance to speak with you, sir.
You go down and see him quite often?
Aye. Oh, yes, of course, whenever I get the chance.
Your father hasn't a very strong character, Miss Engstrand. He badly needs a hand to guide him.
Yes, I dare say you're right there.
He needs to have someone near him whom he's fond of and whose judgment he respects. He admitted it to me quite openly last time he visited me.
Yes, he said something of the sort to me, too, but... I don't know whether Mrs. Alving will want to lose me, especially now that we've the new orphanage to look after. Besides, I'd hate to leave Mrs. Alving. She's always been so kind to me.
But my dear girl, a daughter's duty naturally would have to ask your mistress's permission first.
Yes, but I don't know whether it would be right for me to keep house for an unmarried man at
what?
My age.
What? My dear child, it's your own father we're talking about.
Yes, but all the same. Of course, if it was a nice house run by a real gentleman.
But my dear Regina...
Someone I could feel affection for and look up to as a father.
Dear, dear child.
Oh, I would so love to go and live in the city. Out here, it's so dreadfully lonely. And you know, don't you, sir, what it means to be all alone in the world? And I'm quick and willing, I think I can say that. Oh, Postmanders, don't you know of a place where I could go?
No. I'm afraid I don't know of anyone at all.
Oh, well. Do please think of me if ever you should.
I certainly will. Would you fetch Mrs. Alvin down for me?
Certainly, sir. Pastor.
Good morning, Mrs. Alving. Well, I've kept my promise.
Punctual as always.
But you know, it wasn't easy for me to get away. All these blessed committees I sit on.
All the kinder of you to arrive in such good time. Now we can get our business settled before lunch. But, where is your luggage?
My portmanteau is down at the village. I shall be sleeping there.
I can't persuade you to spend a night in my house even now.
No, Mrs. Alving. It's very kind of you. But I shall sleep down there as usual. It's more convenient for when I go on board again.
As you please. Though I really think two old people such as you and me...
Bless me, you must be joking. But then you must be very happy. The great day tomorrow, and you have Oswald home again.
Yes. You can imagine how happy that makes me. It's 2 years since he was home last. And now he has promised to stay with me the whole winter.
No, has he really? Well, he knows his filial duty. I fancy life in Paris and Rome must offer altogether different attractions.
Yes, but his home is here and his mother.
It would be sad indeed if distance and dabbling in art and such things should blunt his natural affections.
It would indeed. I shall be amused to see whether you recognize him again. He'll be down later. He's upstairs just now taking a little rest on the sofa. But please, sit down, my dear pastor.
Thank you. Are you sure this is a convenient moment?
Certainly.
Very well. To begin with, Mrs. Alving, tell me, what are these books doing here?
Those books, I'm reading them.
You read writings of this kind?
Certainly I do.
And does this kind of reading make you feel better, happier?
I think they make me feel more secure.
How extraordinary. In what way?
They explain and confirm many things that puzzle me. There isn't really anything new in these books. There's nothing that most people haven't already thought for themselves. It's just that most people either haven't fully realized it or they won't admit it.
Oh, dear God. Do you seriously believe that most people...
Yes, I do.
But surely not people from this country. Not people like us.
Yes, of course, people like us.
Well, really, I must say...
What do you object to in these books?
Object to? You surely don't imagine I spend my time studying such publications.
In other words, you've no idea what you're condemning?
I've read quite enough about these writings to disapprove of them.
Don't you think you ought to form your own opinion?
My dear Mrs. Alving, there are many occasions in life when one must rely on the judgment of others. That is the way things are. It is good they should be so. If it were not so, then what would become of society?
Yes. Yes, you may be right.
Of course, I don't deny that there may be quite a lot that is attractive about these writings. And I cannot exactly blame you for wishing to keep informed of these intellectual movements from the great world outside, about which one hears so much. After all, you have allowed your son to wander there for a number of years, but...
But?
But one does not have to talk about it, Mrs. Alving.
No, of course not.
Remember the duty you owe this orphanage, which you decided to found at a time when your attitude towards spiritual matters was quite different from what it is now, as far as I can judge.
Yes. Yes, it's perfectly true. But it was the orphanage that we were going to discuss.
Yes, it was the orphanage we were going to discuss. But, dear Mrs. Alving, be discreet. Now let us turn to our business. You see these?
Are those the deeds?
Yes, all of them ready and completed. Now, as you can imagine, it's been no easy task for me to get them all through in time. I really had to get out my whip. The authorities can be almost painfully conscientious when it comes to getting a decision from them. But here we have them, nevertheless. Now, here is the executed deed of conveyance for the farmstead named Solbik in the manor of Rosenfeld, with its newly constructed buildings, schoolrooms, staff accommodation, and chapel. And here is the settlement of the endowment and the trust deed of the institution. Look. Deed of trust for the Captain Alving Memorial Home.
So there it is.
I thought I'd put Captain rather than Chamberlain. Captain looks less ostentatious.
Yes, yes, as you think best.
And here is the bank book for the capital, which has been placed on deposit to cover the running expenses of the orphanage.
Thank you. I think it would be better if you kept that, if you don't mind.
Certainly, certainly. Admittedly, the interest isn't very attractive. 4% with 6 months' notice of withdrawal. If we could obtain a good mortgage later, of course, it would have to be a first mortgage. And of unimpeachable security, we could reconsider the matter.
Yes, well, dear Pastor Manders, you know best about all that.
Good. Well, I'll keep my eyes open. Now, there is another matter I have several times been meaning to ask you about.
What is that?
Should the buildings of the orphanage be insured or not?
Well, of course they must be insured.
Ah, but wait a minute, Mrs. Alving. Let us consider this question a little more closely.
Everything I have is insured. Buildings, furniture, crops, livestock.
Yes, on your own estate, naturally, I do the same. But this is quite a different matter. The orphanage is, so to speak, to be consecrated to a higher purpose.
Yes, but surely
now, as far as I personally am concerned, I see nothing offensive in securing ourselves against all eventualities.
Well, I certainly don't.
But what is the feeling among the local people out here? You can judge that better than I.
The feeling?
Well, are there many people with the right to an opinion? I mean, people who really have the right to hold an opinion who might take offense.
What do you mean by people who might have the right to hold an opinion?
Well, I'm thinking chiefly of people sufficiently independent and influential to make it impossible for one to ignore their opinions altogether.
Yes, I suppose there are quite a few people
who might... You see, in town we have a great many such people. People might very easily come to the conclusion that neither you nor I had sufficient trust in the ordinance of a higher power.
Yes, but my dear pastor, as long as you yourself...
Yes, I know. My conscience is clear, that is true. But all the same, we couldn't prevent a false and unfavorable interpretation being placed on our action. And that might well adversely influence the purpose for which the orphanage has been dedicated.
Well, if that is
and
so,
I can't altogether close my eyes to the difficult, I might even say deeply embarrassing, position in which I might find myself. Among influential circles in town, there is a great interest in the cause of the orphanage. After all, it is to serve the town as well, and it is hoped it may considerably ease the burden on the ratepayers in respect of the poor. But since I've been your adviser and acted on the business side, I must admit I fear certain overzealous persons might in the first instance direct their attacks against me.
Well, you mustn't lay yourself open to that.
Not to speak of attacks which would undoubtedly be launched against me in certain newspapers.
That settles it.
Then you do not wish the orphanage to be insured?
No, we will forget it.
But suppose an accident should occur. You never can tell. Would you be able to make good the damage?
No, quite frankly, I couldn't.
But you see, this is really a rather serious responsibility we are taking on our shoulders. But I don't think there is any real alternative. We must not lay ourselves open to misinterpretation, and we have no right to antagonize public opinion.
At any rate, you as a clergyman must not.
And I really think we must feel that such an institution will have luck on its side, that it stands under special protection.
Let us hope so, Pastor Manders.
Shall we take the risk, then?
Yes, let us.
Good. As you wish. No insurance, then.
It's strange you happened to mention this today.
I've often thought of raising the matter.
Yesterday we almost had a fire down there.
What?
Oh, it is nothing really, just some shavings caught fire in the carpentry shop.
Where Engstrand works?
Yes. They say he's very careless with matches.
Yes. He has so many things to worry about, poor man. I thank heaven he's now resolved to lead a virtuous life.
Oh, who says so?
Oh, he's told me so himself. And he's a good worker.
Yes, as long as he keeps sober.
Yes, that is a grievous weakness. But he's often compelled to yield to it because of his bad leg, he says. Last time he came to see me, I was quite touched. He came up to me and thanked me so sincerely for getting him this job here so that he could be near Regina.
I don't think he sees her very often.
Oh, yes. He told me himself. He talks to her every day.
Oh? Well, possibly.
He's so conscious of his need to have someone near him who can restrain him when temptation presents itself. That's what's so lovable about Jacob Engstrand. When he comes to one like a child and accuses himself and admits his weakness. The last time he came up and talked to me... Tell me, Mrs. Alving, If it became vital for the poor man to have Regina back to live with him again.
Regina?
You must not oppose it.
I certainly shall. Anyway, Regina is going to work at the orphanage.
But don't forget, he is her father.
I know very well the kind of father he's been to her. No, I shall never consent to Regina going back to him.
My dear Mrs. Alving, you mustn't get so emotional about it. You seem quite frightened. It's very sad the way you misjudged this poor man, Engstrand.
Never mind that. I've taken Regina into my house, and here she shall stay. Let us talk no more about it. Listen. I hear Oswald coming downstairs. Now we will think of nothing but him.
I'm sorry, I thought you were in the study. Good morning, Pastor.
It's most extraordinary.
Well, Pastor Manders, what do you think of him?
I think. But is this really...
Yes, this really is the prodigal son, Pastor.
Dear young friend.
Well, the son, anyway.
Oswald is thinking of the time when you used to be so strongly opposed to his becoming a painter.
Well, many a step which to human eyes seems dubious often turns out... Anyway, welcome, welcome, my dear Oswald. I trust you'll allow me to call you by your Christian name.
What else?
You mustn't think I condemn the artistic profession out of hand. I presume there are many who succeed in keeping the inner man untarnished in that profession, too.
Oh, well, let us hope so.
I know one person who has remained pure both inwardly and outwardly. Just look at him, Pastor.
Yes, yes, Mother dear, please.
Unquestionably. There's no denying it. Besides, you've begun to acquire a name now. The newspapers speak of you so often and in the most flattering terms. That is to say, I don't seem to have read quite so much about you lately.
Well, I haven't done so much painting lately.
Even painters have to rest now and then.
I suppose so. To prepare themselves and conserve their energies for some great work.
Yes. Mother, shall we be eating soon?
In about half an hour. He still enjoys his food, thank heaven.
And his tobacco, I see.
I found Father's pipe upstairs in the bedroom, so I...
Of course.
What do you mean?
When Oswald appeared in that doorway with that pipe in his mouth, it was as though Alving was alive again.
Oh, really?
Oh, can you say that? Oswald takes after me.
Oh, yes. But there is an expression at the corner of his mouth, something about his lips, that reminds me so vividly of Alving.
How can you say that? Oswald has much more the mouth of a clergyman, I think.
Yes. Some of my colleagues have similar expressions.
But put away that pipe, my dear. I don't want any smoke in here.
I'm sorry, I only wanted to try it. You see, I smoked it once when I was a child.
What?
Yes, I remember. I was quite small at the time. I went upstairs to see Father in his room one evening. He was so happy and cheerful.
You remember nothing of that time?
No, I remember it very clearly. He picked me up, sat me on his knee, and let me smoke his pipe. Puff away, boy, he said. Puff hard. I puffed as hard as I could. I felt myself go pale, and the sweat broke out in my forehead in great drops, and that made him roar with laughter.
Oh, very strange.
My dear, it's just something that Oswald has dreamed.
No, I didn't dream it, Mother. Well, surely you must remember, you came in and carried me back to the nursery, and then I was sick, and I saw you crying. Did Father often play jokes like that?
In his youth, he was extremely... He was very high-spirited.
And yet he managed to achieve so much. Well, so much that was good and useful, although he died so young.
Yes, you have inherited the name of an industrious and worthy man, my dear Oswald Alving. I trust this will spur you on.
Yes, it ought to, oughtn't it?
Anyway, it was good of you to come home and join us in honouring him.
It was the least I could do for Father.
The best thing of all is that I have him here for so long.
Yes, I hear you're staying in the winter.
Yes, I am here for an indefinite period, Pastor. Oh, well, it's good to be home.
Oh, yes, Oswald, isn't it?
Yes, you went out into the world early, my dear Oswald.
Yes, I did. I sometimes wonder if it wasn't too early.
Nonsense. It's good for a healthy boy, especially if he's an only child. It's bad for them to be kept at home with their mother and father and be pampered.
Well, now, that is a debatable point, Mrs. Alving. When all is said and done, the parental home is where a child belongs.
Oh, I agree with you there, Pastor.
Take your own son. Well, it'll do no harm to talk about it in his presence. What has been the consequence for him? Here he is, 24 years old. He's never had the opportunity to know what a real home is like.
Oh, I beg your pardon, but there you're quite mistaken.
Oh? I thought you spent practically all your time in artistic circles.
Yes, I have.
Mostly among young artists.
Yes.
But I thought most of those people lacked the means to support a family and make a home for themselves.
Well, most of them can't afford to get married.
Is that what I'm saying?
Yes, but that doesn't mean they can't have a home. Some of them do, and very good and comfortable homes at that.
Ah, but I'm not talking of bachelor establishments. By a home, I mean a family establishment where a man may live with his wife and children.
Quite. Or with his children and their mother.
Merciful heavens, you don't.
Yes?
Lives with the mother of his children.
Oh, would you rather he disowned the mother of his children?
Wait, so you are talking of unlegalized relationships, free marriages?
I've never noticed anything particularly free about the way such people live.
But how is it possible that any reasonably well-brought-up man or young woman could bring themselves to live like that openly for all to see?
Well, what else can they do? A poor young artist, a poor young girl, it costs a